Well, good morning, everyone. It's so good to see each and every one of you. Last week, we had a tremendous, tremendous service here at the church with our VBS Sunday. If you missed last week, you truly missed a blessing. It was great to see all the kids up here, to see the parents, to interact with them. And church, we have found our niche, I believe, what our church is about, and that's reaching the next generation. Seeing all the kids that were here, and volunteers, adults, church, all those involved in helping and praying, I think it was a tremendous success. On the back table, I don't have a copy with me, but I have a letter that I sent out to all those that were here last week, gave them a copy. If you have not received a copy, please take one. Church, that's even for you as well, because I know that you all were instrumental in that. You say, well, how was I involved? Well, such things as budgeting for VBS, we could not do that without the finances that you all set aside for that. You prayed for VBS, and you were a big help to that. And again, from the bottom of my heart, thank you. Thank you for all that you did for that. Just a couple of brief announcements before we get into our worship hour. Next week, looking forward to where our church is going as far as our first hour, and we did have something set aside during that first hour, but in talking with the deacons, I think it's important enough, and they think it's important enough, that could be during our 10:30 service, and that's about church membership. Whether you've been a church member for 50 years, 5 years, 5 minutes, that is a message for you. And you may ask, well, what does it even mean to be a church member? Well, come next week at 10:30 because we're going to be having a church membership message, what it means to be a church member as a whole. And so I have some points. A lot of it comes from, I am a church member, from Tom Rayner. I do believe that the church received a copy of this. How many years ago was it? But some really good principles that we'll be discussing next week during our 10:30 service. So looking forward to that. And then the week after, on August 22nd, there will be part two, and that's going to be a little bit more detailed, a little bit more specific. So if you are not a church member, I would like to meet with you personally, whether it's over in the conference room or downstairs. We have a few families that are interested in joining our church. If you're interested in joining Fulton Baptist Temple, please come to that, and that will be at 9:15 on August 22nd. And that will be just those who are not members, but desire to be members, and I'll meet with you personally, have a conversation with you, talk with you, and then from there, afterward, we'll bring you before the church, and the church throws tomatoes at you, right? Is that how it goes? No, just kidding. But we'll welcome you to the Fulton Baptist Temple as a church member. And as far as announcements like that, we'll have some more at a later time, but those are just a few specific things really wanted to cover with you. Church, let's stand. We're going to have a word of prayer, and then we'll get right into our worship time. Let's pray together. Father, it's so good to see the faces of our church family. Lord, we thank you for their love for this community. Thank you, Lord, for a great week that we had this past week at church, but also we look forward to the direction that you're driving us toward. And Lord, help us to be closer to you. Help us to lead others to you, and help us to be examples of what Christ was and who Christ is. And I pray now that you just bless this service, bless each of the families who are here. Thank you, Lord, for their willingness to come out and for their time, their priorities that they set a time for you this morning. Be with our families who are sick and who are down. I pray that you'll encourage them this morning as they so desperately want to be here with their church family. Bless this time, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Remain standing as we sing.
Good morning. Let's try one more time. Good morning.
Good morning.
That was really for me just to make sure my microphone works. Sorry about that. But that was a nice hearty good morning. We are glad you're here. If you were not here for VBS last week, man, what a great time it was. To see all the kids sing the whole week. I actually missed Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and then I was quarantined to the balcony by the director for Thursday. But got to spend Friday kind of just roaming around, and man, what an awesome week, and I so missed it. But it was so great just to see it and to hear the kids sing and to hear, to see the stories done and the fun they had in games, and unbelievable. And we only are able to do that because of what God does. He blesses the things of his to further his kingdom, and we thank him for that. So this morning we're going to begin with "Praise Him, Jesus, our Blessed Redeemer." This morning to be here together. We praise you and we thank you for the awesome God that you are, for the loving and compassionate God that you are. And I just I pray that you would hear the songs from our hearts this morning, for Lord, you have redeemed us, you have bought us out of death and brought us into life. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. You can remain standing. It's that amazing grace that we sing. Amen. Greeted neighbors, you're being seated this morning.
Good morning. What a great group on what a great summer day. I love these summer days, and I'll take every one of them. Hey, just a couple announcements. I'm not going to take much time. Jeremy covered quite a bit this morning, but I just want to draw your attention to the quarterly business meeting tonight at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary. Definitely, if you're a member of our church, please come. We have some decisions we need to make, or if you're not a member, just come. We have a good time. It's not like a business meeting where you got to sit there and be quiet. We do have a lot of fun, and there'll be a building update. I know that you guys have probably been driving by the building going, what is going on inside that place? It doesn't look like it's changed, but it has made some major changes over there. All the drywall is hung, and they're getting ready to mud it and put the walls up in terms of the what goes on the outside. There's metal that goes on the inside of the walls, so it's coming together. So just going to provide a financial update on the building tonight if you're interested in that. Also, the men's breakfast is next Saturday morning, and I think we're going to have that in the church basement. We're going to move that back over here to the church basement. So calling all men, we have a great time. We really have been digging into scriptures and just having fun, and we've been eating really good. So if you're interested in that, we'd love to have you on Saturday morning. I'd never miss it. Okay, and then also you can see that the women's breakfast will be on the 21st, and I think it'll also be in the church basement as well. Christian Ed meeting, if you're in that group, August 22nd, we will meet at 6 o'clock in the church basement. And then is there anything else we need to add in terms of announcements? Anything that I missed? Yes.
Real quick, there's some stuff down on the tables in the basement left over from BBS. That is up for grabs. Whatever's left after today is going to Goodwill. So if you want it, you take it. That way, if parents and kids come up with it, you don't have to worry about asking if they can take it or not. If it's on the table down there, they can take it. Kids, take all you want. Your parents said you can have anything that you want off the table.
That means Chinese umbrellas, pink flamingos, random old stuff.
Okay, if you didn't hear that, there's a table downstairs, got leftover VBS stuff, and you can have it all. If it's left after today, it's going to Goodwill. So just make sure if you didn't hear Daniel. So are there any updates to our prayer requests here on the back of our sheet? Jimmy. I'll repeat that so you guys can hear. Jimmy requested prayer for Mark and Mary Babb. They've been sick this past week, so we know there's stuff going around. So just keep them in prayer. And, you know, especially Mark with his diabetes, you know, that flares up and it gets in his feet real bad. So we know that Mark has been fighting that for years. But, you know, when you're sick on top of it, it makes a big difference. So jot him down. Pray for Mark and Mary Babb this week. Anything else? Anything? Yeah. Want to add anything? Nobody? Going once? Okay, the ushers come forward. All right, let's pray together. Lord, we just thank you so much for the blessings that you've given to this church. Lord, we thank you for this place that we can come and worship you freely. Lord, we thank you for all of the people that are here today. And we pray for those who couldn't make it, Lord, for the audience that's watching online. Lord, we thank you for that opportunity that we have to broadcast this message out through the internet, Lord, we pray that you would just bless all of us here and there and everywhere today. Lord, we ask that you would have a special prayer for Mark and Mary, Lord, as they're sick right now. Lord, we just ask that you would continue to heal them. Lord, we ask for a time of blessing over them. Lord, we just also want to pray for our FBT building, the new project that we have going on. Lord, we just pray that you would continue to bless that project. Lord, provide safety for the workers over there, and we just ask that you would bring that all together for us. Lord, we ask that as we give a small portion back today through our offering, Lord, we just ask that you would multiply it for your kingdom, Lord, so that we can reach others for you, Lord. We thank you so much for your son, Jesus, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Before we sing our next song this morning, if you weren't here last week, we're going to go ahead and show the video from the Cockrells. Didn't know if you noticed on your way in. You may not even pay attention to it from week to week, but there's a number back on this board back here for VBS. About the most that we've ever gotten in a week for our missionaries. It's about $1,600. This year, the kids and the parents brought in $2,653. That's all going down to the Cockrells. It's all, it's none of us stays here. We always, that's, and we tell everybody that's the only time we ever ask for money is because we're sending it somewhere else. So to be able to send $2,600 to the Cockrells, it's a huge deal. We know God's going to multiply that. But I want to show this quick video here of the Cockrells, Aaron talking about what they're going to do with this money.
Hello, I'm Aaron Cockrell. You're a missionary to Peru, South America. What an exciting, wonderful week it has been. It has been so special for us to watch as the kids of your church have been able to come and sing the songs and play the games in that stretch of duct tape that started out and has grown all the way around the church. What a special blessing this week has been. But in many ways, God is using this week as a double blessing. A double blessing? How does that work? God is using this week as a double blessing as boys and girls of your church and in your area come and hear about Jesus and how they can faithfully follow him. But not only is God doing that there, God is using your week at VBS to be an encouragement to the work as we teach people to follow Jesus here. That's what we want to share a little bit with you about at this time. We are just about to start the construction of our church. But as we look to start building a building, we don't want to just focus on raising up four walls and a roof. No, it's so much more than that. Yes, we want to have a building that God can use for this church. But if we just focus on the end result and the building we hope to have, we've missed the blessing all along the way. So, in each stage and phase of construction, we want to use that step, that stage that we're currently in, to help others learn about Jesus. How will that work? I'm glad you asked. That'll work in such a way that we say we're going to offer free construction workshops. There are many, many men who earn their living by working in construction. But often, to be able to improve themselves in construction is hard, and they're not able to do that very easily. And so we desire to offer these free construction workshops where we say, okay, we're in the phase where we need to read a blueprint and see how we put that into practice. Well, let's teach people how to use a blueprint, how to read it and put it into practice. God miraculously saved an engineer, and it hasn't been that long since she's known the Lord. And she's willing to come and say, here's how you read the blueprint. And that is what we will ask people to come and learn to do. But then when they come and that's their desire to learn and improve in their work, we will then share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. Then when we're ready to dig the footers, we will say, come and here's a free workshop on how to dig a footer, how deep, how wide, how to know exactly how to do it. And then we will share the gospel. We're ready to build rebar towers. Come and learn how to build rebar towers. And they bend the rebar and they see how that's done. And then we share the gospel of Jesus Christ. What a wonderful tool that God has given us to not just build a building and finish a final goal that we hope to achieve, but all along the process to be able to teach people how to improve themselves in their work, yes, but to use that in such a way that we can also help them know who Jesus is and that he loves them and wants to have have a personal relationship with them. That is what all the offerings that you guys have raised this week will go towards, helping us offer these free construction workshops and allowing them to see the love of Christ in a practical way and that they need Him as their personal Savior. So we want to thank you. Thank you for all that you've done. Thank you for the way that you are impacting lives there for Jesus Christ. But thank you for the way that you are allowing us to do the same thing here. We hope you have a great rest of your week, and may God bless you richly.
On that, if you would stand with us, great is thy faithfulness. There are so many ways we see throughout our short, brief history, throughout all of history, how God is faithful all the time. We don't always see it, but we know and we trust that He is faithful. Praise the name of Jesus. We do that. Sorry, my ears are so plugged, I can't even hardly hear. But I cast my mind to Calvary where He bled and died. Okay, so it's not me. I thought, man, my ears are really bad. I can't even hear the music. So we got an issue going on with the clavin over here.
It's not the player.
It's not the player.
Well, I do have issues, but this one is not me. All right, we'll try it again.
Let's try her again.
All right. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see.
seated.
I thought I was going to have to play solo without the clavinova, and then I thought to myself, everyone's going to hear how bad of a guitar player I am, and this isn't good. But thank you, Lord, for helping us through that. But it's been a joy, church, to minister to you, to minister with you, and to journey along with you this past year. As you all know, it's been over a year now since the church had a business meeting and voted me on to be your pastor, and I am thankful. I'm thankful for each and every one of you. If you're watching this morning, I'm thankful for you as well. You've been a blessing. The emails, the calls, the texts over the past year, and yes, Roller, it's even been a blessing getting texts from you. So he's been giving me a hard time this morning, so I can give it right back. But no, it's been a true blessing. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Galatians chapter 4. Galatians chapter 4, and a couple of things that I want to highlight again. Next week, we're going to take a brief break from Galatians, and whether it takes next week or also takes 2 weeks, unsure yet, but I really want to nail down what is a church member, because we have a few families that would like to join our church, but before we have a class for them, I also wanted to open it up to you all. So if you have been a regular attender for a while and you're wondering what does it mean to be a church member, come by next Sunday, 10:30. We're going to be having a church membership class, if you will, but it's really going to be a message on what a church member really is all about. And then if you still have more questions on what a church member really is, we're going to have part two, and that's going to be more of a smaller setting. The regular 9:15 service will, or 9:15 begin series will continue upstairs, and we'll either meet downstairs if we have more than who have talked to me already, or we'll have it over in the conference room. Either way, but that'll be a time for you to question and answer. And get some input on what it means to be a church member of this church, Fulton Baptist Temple. Next week's going to be what does it mean to be a church member as a whole, and then if you're still interested in becoming a church member of our church, please come to the next week, the 9:15 service, and that's where we'll discuss what it means to be a church member of our church. And then also, baptisms. We would like to do a baptism class at 9:15 on August 29th. So if you're interested in any of your family being baptized or yourself being baptized, you say, I don't know if I've ever done that, or maybe I did, or what have you. Maybe you got saved a little bit later in life, and maybe you were baptized first, and so we'll clear up all of those distinctions and what it truly means to be baptized. And so please come at that August 29th at 9:15, and it will be a baptism class. And then September 5th, excited for that, we'll be baptizing those that come to that class and have a conversation with myself and what it means to be baptized. So there's a few things to look forward to. Also, something to look forward to today, right after church. VBS got me all excited. So I'm really excited about VBS, excited for FBT clubs. And when we started VBS that week, we started it with prayer. We had a special time with those that came to the 9:15 Sunday school hour, and where we just broke up into small groups. And what a tremendous blessing that was. What a great time that we had just to pray. And so what I would like to do after church, it wasn't in the bulletin, it wasn't anything scheduled, but if you have time this afternoon, and if you've never seen the FBT Center, and maybe you've seen the outside, like Daniel was saying, but you've never seen the inside, please come right after church, as soon as we dismiss from here, give a little bit of time, and we'll make our way over there, we'll unlock it, you can go through the building. It is a construction zone, so maybe a little dusty, so if you're wearing nice shoes, that's all right, it'll wipe right off, but come by, see the building, and then if it's too warm inside, we'll meet outside to pray. But I just want to have a special time of prayer over that building, and one of these days after it opens, we'll have maybe a grand opening service or something over there where everybody can see the finished product. But it's still in its construction site, and it's still in its construction phase, and I think it's important that we pray. Again, it's not just because we're there praying that makes all the difference. You can still pray in your home for that building and for the kids that will come for FBT clubs, but I think it'd just be a great time for you to see inside the building, to see what's going on in there, and say, this building is going to be used for God, and we're going to have a special time of prayer over that. So if you can join us right after the service, I would love to see you over there, and we'll have a time of prayer. Back to Galatians chapter 4. Again, we took a brief break from our Galatians series last week when we did VBS Sunday. And as I was talking to Kristen and the guys and Aaron about what goes on during FPT Sunday, I had no idea what it was. And I was full preparing this sermon. I was ready to deliver this sermon. I thought I knew we were going to have a handful of guests. I did not realize the amount of guests we would have. And so I thought it was just going to be a normal Sunday. And then I was quickly reminded that you have 10 minutes. 10 minutes? That's it? I mean, we have to cover 11 verses in Galatians 4. There's no way. And so it was more of just a recap, but it was a blessing, wasn't it? If you were here last week, it truly was a blessing. And I hope that next year when VBS happens, that you'll make it a point to come out for that Sunday and see the families that who are here, or even see the volunteers, because I think we had 15 or so volunteers that are not regular attenders or members of our church or members of other churches that even helped with our VBS, and be able to interact with them and realize that we're working together with these kids and teaching them about Christ. And it was a blessing to see all that, to see the amount of work and 60 plus volunteers that it took to make VBS happen. But again, while we were ministering to the missionaries to Peru, of course, we saw the video from Aaron Cockrell, and I took a few pictures of VBS, and he saw the tape, and I explained what that was, and you might still see, not here, but out there, you might see a little bit of remnants of tape. What we did was every dollar that we raised, it was a foot of track. And if you needed black or yellow duct tape, you were out of luck if you went to any of the Walmarts, because the amount of money that these kids raised, we had strips of duct tape going everywhere. So I sent pictures to Aaron. I said, this is what's going on. So he was excited to see that. And so he made that video for us. And so last week, we were emphasizing giving to the Cockrells, doing doing the Lord's work over in the Southern Hemisphere, in South America. But I think so often we so minister to that's the mission field, or the mission field is in Russia, or the ministry field is in Europe, but we're forgetting our own mission field right here in Fulton, Indiana. We're missing that mark. And what happens, we put all of our emphasis everywhere else. It's great that we do that, church. I love that we're mission-minded, but we cannot forget our own mission right here in our own community. And I think what happens is what eventually happened to the Galatian church, that far too often they're forgetting the mission, and they're implementing all these rules and regulations within what their church is all about, and you get letters like this that the writer of Galatians is saying to the church, saying, you missed the point. You've left your first love, as Jesus writes to the church in Revelation. You've lost your love for me. You've lost your love for your community. You've lost your love for what it means to be a believer in Jesus Christ. I loved how faithful and caring that the kids were. I know that they did a lot for a competition, but still in the back of their mind, they had an idea of where that money was going. It was on Wednesday, or Tuesday or Wednesday, and a boy, it was one of the days that the girls won, and he said, you wait till Friday. And he couldn't wait to either break into his savings account or whatever have you. I mean, because I think the boys won then Friday, so it might have been him that put him over the top, however much it was. But he was so excited to give. He was so excited and thrilled to be able to support that ministry. And again, church, I'm so thrilled that we have the opportunity to minister to those kids as well, right here in our own community. Again, it was a blessing. You'll hear me say that over and over and over again. But I was just shocked by the amount of love that our church showed to this community and how much the kids loved being here. So thank you, church, for making VBS a priority. And again, I can say this again. There's letters on that back table. Please grab one, and that's a letter for you. But I'm looking and starting to pray already for VBS 2022, and Kristen just shudders. But all right, it's already picked out. We're going with a theme, and we'll see what happens. Galatians 4, I told you how many times now to turn there. I hope you're there by now. But let's pick up in verse number 21. Tell me, you who desire to be under the law, it says in verse 21, Do you not listen to the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, one by a slave woman and one by a free woman. But the son of the slave was born according to the flesh, while the son of the free woman was born through promise. Now this may be interpreted allegorically. These women are two covenants. One is from Mount Sinai, bearing children for slavery. She is Hagar. Now Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia. She corresponds to the present Jerusalem, for she is in slavery with her children. But the Jerusalem above is free, and she is our mother. For it is written, "Rejoice, O barren one who does not bear. Break forth and cry aloud, you who are not in labor. For the children of the desolate one will be more than those of the one who has a husband. Now you, brothers, like Isaac, are children of promise. But just as the time he who was born according to the flesh persecuted him who was born according to the spirit, so also it is now. But what does the scripture say? Cast out the slave woman and her son, for the son of the slave woman shall not inherit with the son of the free woman. So brothers, we are not children of the slave, but of the free woman. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery." So what is going on in this passage? And why, Pastor, are you choosing this passage to go through? It's confusing. Who's the prophet Isaiah? Why is he in Galatians? Mount Sinai, Abraham, Hagar, Sarah, slavery, freedom, etc. All that's mentioned here in this passage. And we wonder to ourselves, what is Paul? What are you talking about? This isn't making any sense to us. And I can guarantee you, if we would preach topically, this isn't a passage that I would ever choose. This isn't a passage that you go to and there's so much depth of knowledge that it's just going to be groundbreaking. But it's a passage that is deep. As we look into it, we'll see truly what this text is talking about. And so this morning's message is slightly different. I'm going to have an explanation of the passage, but then also from it, you have application points that we can apply to our daily life from this passage. Because we know in 2 Timothy 3:16 that all scripture is breathed out by God. It's profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. So what kind of teaching, what kind of reproof, what kind of correction can we get out of this passage? I have a quote here from Tim Keller. I almost forgot his name. But what the Galatians were dealing with was this simple truth, that they thought, if I obey, I am accepted. But it's this is the truth. The gospel says, no, I'm accepted, therefore I obey. See, the Galatian church was, they had this backwards. They thought that if they would continue to obey, that God would accept them for their actions and for their righteousness. But that's not it at all. The gospel message is simply this, that God has already accepted you. God has reached out and said, I want to redeem you. I want you to be part of my family. I don't want you to be a child of wrath anymore, as Ephesians tells us. But no, I want you to be a child of God. You're accepted. You're loved. You're part of my family. And because of that, we say, I want to obey him. How many times have maybe you heard this growing up? I know I've said it before. But so do we have to go to church? Heard a story of a man, he was complaining to mom, boy, he was complaining to his mom and saying, Mom, do I gotta go to church? There's people there, they'll talk about me, they're just, I don't know, Mom, they're in church and they don't really want to be there and I don't want to be there and there's people there, they get mad at me and I just don't think I could do anything right. And mom says to the boy, Son, I know I'm visiting this week, but you have to go to church. You're the pastor. And a lot of times that's how we feel. We don't want to go to church. We don't want to become a church member. We don't want to do this. We don't want to do that because we think in doing so, that's what accepts that, what makes God accept us. Whereas it's the opposite. Because God has loved us, we say, I get to go to church. I get to fellowship with other believers. I get to be a part of the greater vision that God has. I may only look this far, but God's vision for our church is so much past our line of sight. But as God reveals what he wants our church to do, we just continue to walk down that path and keep moving forward and striving to please him. But what happened with the Galatian church here? Why is Paul using this allegory to the Galatian church? And what happened to this church that Paul is saying that freedom in Christ is better than this yoke of slavery? It's better than bondage. And what is the bondage that Paul is talking about here? And so why did the Galatian churches even entertain this idea? What lessons can we learn from this church and these four churches that our church in the 21st century, that we do not fall into the same trap? After all, the Galatian church was flourishing. It was discipling. It was leading others to Christ, and they were expanding. They were following after what they believed God wanted them to do. Then it seemed that everything just came to a standstill. The Galatian churches were forgiven of their sins. They were teaching, they were preaching that their sins can be forgiven. The Galatian church knew of this salvation. They knew that they could inherit life. Remember our message from a few weeks ago about the inheritance and the benefits of it? And they knew these things. So does our church. We know of the salvation of that comes through faith by grace and grace alone. We know the fruits of the Spirit. We know how we should act. We know what we should say and what we should do. But what happens? Do we fall into the same trap that the Galatians fell into? So what happened? The Jews came from Jerusalem here in our passage. They said that they also believed in Jesus. There's the issue. They came with this deceit, this underlying deceit about them. The deceivers came in, they claimed one thing, but they taught another. And it was so subtle. It wasn't anything that they stood behind this, the lectern of the church and proclaimed and preached. No, they started talking amongst themselves, and they started winning others over to their own side and backbiting and doing all of these things behind closed doors, as we looked at this morning in John 3, that Nicodemus, he was confused about these things. And Jesus mentioned that about light and darkness and how men love darkness more than light and their deeds are evil. And so all these things were going on behind the scenes. And Paul is saying here, what happened, church? What happened? I thought you loved God. I thought you were after the Lord Jesus Christ and his mission. But it says over in verses 10 of chapter 4 that they focus on days and months and seasons and years. They were more or less looking at the things that the Pharisees and the legalists were telling them to do, that you have to recognize all of these different seasons. You have to recognize all these different meals, and that's what leads you to salvation. But again, it's not. I obey, therefore I am accepted. That's what religion says. But whereas the gospel says, I am accepted, therefore I obey. And we often think that religion, this term, oh, I'm religious, but sometimes that word has been hijacked from us, as we looked at a few months ago now with our Real Christianity series. But really, this is what religion should be all about. That word religion that Tim Keller is using in that context is the worldview of religion nowadays. But the Bible term for religion is found in James chapter 1, verse 27. It's that religion that is pure. Religion is a Bible term. We cannot let that term be hijacked from us, because Scripture says, James 1, 27, religion that is pure and undefiled before God is this, to visit the orphans and widows in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained from the world. That's what religion should be all about. But again, as we looked at many months ago now, that term has been hijacked from us. So let us reclaim that truth. Let us reclaim that this passage here was a warning, not just at this church in the first century, but it's also a warning for us in the 21st century. So let's get right into the application of this passage. Let's first describe what's going on in the first few verses, 21 through 26. That number one, salvation is from a promise. Salvation is from a promise. That's something that the Galatian churches, they knew. They understood that this promise was all the way back in Genesis 3:15. God promises, he says, I will put enmity between you and the woman. He's speaking to Satan here. He says, in between your offspring and her offspring, there's already that battle. And then the allegory between Hagar and Sarah. Hagar basically describing this Jewish, for lack of better terms, this Jewish religion that they held to, whereas the future promise of Sarah and her offspring being not just Jews, but also to the Gentiles, the gospel believers. Between your offspring and her offspring, he shall bruise your head. Yes, your head will be bruised, and you shall bruise his heel. There's a much crushing blow when it comes to a head versus heel. Then God is saying, Satan, you will harm this future offspring, Jesus. You'll bruise his heel, but that heel can be recovered. You can recover from that, but a crushing blow to your head, Satan, your kingdom is going to fall, is what this is speaking of. And that's salvation through a promise. This spiritual allegory, it's an interpretation of a story that has literal meaning. In these few verses here, Isaac was born of the free woman. Ishmael was born of a slave woman. You get this distinction between the two. And so Paul is saying here, listen, Galatian churches, you are a free individual. And you have these Jews, these Judaizers, these deceivers who are coming in and saying that bondage needs to happen to the gospel in order for acceptance to truly happen. And that's what Paul's argument is here. Verse 24, we get into this new covenant. The old covenant was given to Abraham. The old covenant being sacrifices had to be made. And then there's also the promise of the new covenant. Jesus was the fulfillment of that new covenant. It says in Hebrews 12, verse 24, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. You have this distinction between the old covenant and the new covenant. You have this distinction between Ishmael being of the slave woman and Isaac being of the free woman. Again, this is an allegory. Verse 25, it speaks of that Hagar stands for Mount Sinai. It stands for the law, and that these Jewish individuals are saying that only salvation can come by obedience to the law. And that's what Mount Sinai represents. But Sarah represents Jerusalem, the heavenly city of God, where all departed believers go. This represents grace. So you have Mount Sinai on this hand, the law, that you can only be accepted by God if you do works for him. You can only be accepted by God if you obey him. But on this side, it says, no, I obey because I am accepted. That's what Sarah represents in this passage. That's what this is speaking of. You have these contradictions between the two. You have the works that equal salvation over on this side, but then you have salvation that equal works on this side. And that's the essence of the gospel, that we obey because we are accepted. We get to do these things for Jesus. We get to have the opportunity to work for him because he did so much for us. You say, well, what did he do for me? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The gospel, that's what Jesus did for you. That's what God did for you. He sent his son to fulfill that gospel message. Number two, the first application is this, that salvation is from a promise. Second application is this, God's promise now allows us to rejoice. Because of this promise, because of this salvation that we have over on this side, because of the acceptance of God into our lives, we can rejoice. It says in verse 27, and this comes from a direct quote from Isaiah chapter 54, verse 1, but Galatians says, rejoice, O barren one who does not bear. Break forth and cry aloud, you who are not in labor. For the children of the desolate one will be more than those of the one who had a husband. And Isaiah 54 verse 1 says this, sing, O barren one who did not bear. Break forth into singing and cry aloud, you who have not been in labor. For the children of the desolate one will be more than the children of her who is married, says the Lord. See this quote here from Isaiah 54? You see that how much Paul knew the Old Testament and how he was describing that this has now been fulfilled, that the barren one who did not bear, that being Sarah, break forth into singing and cry aloud. You can rejoice. You have not been in labor, for the children of the desolate one will be more than the children of her who is married. Again, this is speaking allegorically, talking about the contrasting the future lineages of the two women, of Sarah being of grace, who at first was, she was barren. She could not have any children, but through the promise, she had her child, and through the Abrahamic covenant, and then eventually through the spiritual children that she would eventually have, being you and I, being of grace. Whereas Ishmael and Hagar, they represented Judaism, they represented law, they represented Mount Sinai. And God's promise allows us to rejoice in that. And the scriptures say, rejoice, O barren one. Rejoice, Sarah. Rejoice. And that's what salvation, that's what the promise will allow us to do. It allows us to rejoice. So another application we can learn from this passage, that salvation allows us to rejoice. Have you ever met a Christian who is just down and not somber, woe is me, like Igor, right? But it's not. That's not what Christianity is all about. God says, rejoice, rejoice. You can have joy as a Christian. You say, but I'm not happy. That's okay. You can still rejoice. You can still be joyful. You can still have that love within you. You say, circumstances around me, I'm just so down. This has happened, that has happened. My truck broke down. This caught on fire. Everything is just all in shambles. But we can still have joy. We can still have joy. Again, our joy is dependent on a relationship with God, whereas happiness is much more this way, that it is based on our circumstances. Two, God's promise allows us to rejoice. Number three, we must cast out Pharisaical thinking. Verse number 28 through 31 says this, just like Isaac and the New Testament saints were children of promise, and just as Isaac, he was subject to Ishmael's persecution, the early Christians were subject to persecution from the legalists. They were persecuted under the Judaizers. By applying this quote from Genesis 21:10, Paul is saying to the Galatian churches, get rid of the legalizers. Get them out from among you. Get rid of them. They're causing this division within your church, and you just need to stop with that type of thinking. And Paul is telling them, this is why your church has lost your love. You've adopted this Pharisaical thinking, just like the Judaizers saying that, no, you have to do all these good things in order to be accepted by God, whereas it's opposite. Because you are accepted, because you are loved, you can in return say, Lord, I want to obey you. And we have to cast out this Pharisaical thinking. Last 2 points. Number 4 and 5 work well together. I'll just say them together. Number 4 is Christ has set us free. And number 5, now stay free. We have to jump over to chapter 5, verse 1. And really, 5, verse 1 really belongs with this paragraph. And sometimes we stop in the middle of a sentence because of the chapter or verse divisions. But let's bring it into chapter 4. Because it deals a lot with this freedom versus slavery. Verse 5, verse 1 says, for freedom, Christ has set us free. Christ has set you free from the bondage, not just of sin, but also the bondage of these man-made rules that we have to do all these things in order to be accepted by God. But no, it's the Christian is set free from the negative effects of the law. So let's not return to it. We would have to keep the whole law perfectly from commandment 1 through commandment 10. And God knew that that was too much for us. God knew that he set the standard of salvation so high, knowing that we cannot get to it. But he said, well, here's a bridge. Here's my son, Jesus Christ. Now that you can walk through. If you believe in him, come salvation. Christ has set us free. And then in verse 5, verse 1, in the latter part of the verse, it says, stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to yoke of slavery. Galatian church, Paul is saying, don't go back to it. Once you've cast out the Pharisees, once you've cast out the Judaizers, don't go back to it. It's going to weigh you down. It's going to cause you to not love one another like Christ loved. It's going to cause you to follow after rule and be so consumed with this idea of religion that you're not of any use to the Lord Jesus. And that's what we need to return back to. 5 verse 1 says, for freedom Christ has set us free. Let's return to that and say to our neighbors, to say to our coworkers, say, do you want to be free? Do you want to be free from that sin? Do you want to be free from that bondage? Well, here's Jesus. This is what the Bible says about Jesus. And you lead them through the gospel. It's a wonderful opportunity to share the gospel. Again, just like Missionary Cockrell, he's going to bring in all these workers that want to better themselves in their work field, but he's going to have the opportunity to share the gospel with them. And you know, church, we have the same opportunity in our community. We can share the gospel. Christ has set us free. Now let's stay free. If you will, we're going to close in prayer. If you will, stand with me. And again, if you have an opportunity, I'd love to meet with you over at the FPT Center, open the door, show you around, walk around, and then we're going to have a special time of prayer. But let's close this service in a word of prayer. We're going to sing, Christ is mine forevermore. But let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your goodness to us, and Lord, we thank you for your mercy. Thank you, Lord, for this passage of Scripture. It seems so difficult at first. But the truths that are found in there is that we should not return to that slavery of sin. We should not return to that slavery of only following after rules because we think that's what will gain us acceptance in you. But Lord, you've already accepted us. I don't know why. I don't know what you see in me. But Lord, the gospel was offered to me. And Lord, help me now to proclaim that truth to this world. Father, dismiss us with your blessing. Lord, help us to honor you in all that we say and all that we do. Bless this time, we pray, in Jesus' name. Remain standing as we sing.
Sure.
promise we have. Let's pray, Father. We're thankful for this day to know that you are the one who gives true freedom. And Lord, when you set us free, we are free indeed. And we rejoice in that. We praise you for that. Pray that each day as we go forward, as this next week, that you would remind us that you would be the voice that is stronger than the enemy telling us what is a lie, with the enemy telling us something different than what your true word says, what you have told us of who we are and the freedom we have in you. I just thank you for this day. In Jesus' name, amen. It's good to see you this morning. Enjoy your week.